Hello everyone, today I will discuss about development of interventricular septum. So we have discussed about the heart tube and we have seen that the primitive ventricle and the bulbous cortex, they form the part of the ventricles. Bulbous cortex has been divided into proximal one third part and the middle one third and distal one third part. Distal one third of the bulbous cortex forms the truncus arteriosus, middle one third of the bulbous cortex is called as conus, and proximal one third part has no special name. Now the distal one third, middle one third of the bulbous cortex, which is called as conus, it forms the smooth outflowing part of the both ventricles, and proximal one third part of the bulbous cortex mainly forms the trabeculated or rough part of the right ventricle, and primitive ventricle mainly forms the rough part of the left ventricle. So bulbous cortex and primitive ventricle together help in formation of the ventricles. So bulbous cortex and primitive ventricle both form a bulboventricular cavity or the common ventricular chamber from which the ventricles will develop. Now coming to the development of interventricular septum, we can see in this diagram that the interventricular septum is made up of three parts: membranous part. First of all is the bulbar part and membranous part and muscular part. So it has got three parts: bulbar, membranous and muscular part. We can see this, this muscular part, which is this one, orangish one, it is developing from the floor of the bulboventricular cavity or the common ventricular chamber. So muscular part is developing from the floor of the ventricle, and bulbar part, as the name is suggesting, it is developing from the bulbar region or the bulbous cortex region. So it is developing in the distal part of the bulbous cortex by two bulbar ridges, which are coming from right and left side, and they fuse in the midline and they will form the bulbar septum. And third part, that is the gap between bulbar septum and the muscular septum, it is called as interventricular foramen, and this gap is filled by membranous part. So interventricular septum is made up of three parts: muscular, bulbar and membranous part. And this membranous part, it is developing from the endocardial cushion, that is the endocardial AV cushion will form the membranous part of the interventricular septum. Now coming to the first part, that is the muscular part, you can see the muscular part is developing from the floor of the bulboventricular cavity, this one. This is the muscular part, and it is the median growth. It is median muscular growth, which is growing upward, and you can see its upper margin is concave, and it is also present in the oblique plane. So muscular part develops from the floor of the common ventricular chamber or the floor of the ventricle, and it is a muscular growth, which is growing upward from the floor of the primitive ventricle, and its upper margin is concave. Now second part, which is the bulbar part. Bulbar part, here you can see this is the right and left bulbar ridges, which are developing in the distal part of the bulbous cortex, or the that in the distal part of the bulbous cortex, they are developing right and left bulbar ridges. They fuse in the midline and they will form the bulbar septum, and this bulbar septum is growing downwards. Initially there will remain a gap between bulbar septum, which is the yellowish one, and the muscular septum, and this gap is called as interventricular foramen, and this gap will be filled by fused AV cushion or the endocardial cushion. Here bluish one is the AV cushions, and from the growth of endocardial cushion, this interventricular foramen will be filled, and this part is called as membranous part. So the bulbar part, it develops from the right and left bulbar ridges, which develops in the distal part of the bulbous cortex. The right and left bulbar ridges fuses in the midline and they will form the bulbar part of the IV septum, which is growing downward. And the gap between bulbar part and the muscular part is called as interventricular foramen. Now coming to the membranous part, this interventricular foramen is filled by membranous septum, and this membranous septum is formed by proliferation of AV cushions. This bluish one is the endocardial AV cushions, and due to proliferation of this AV cushion, this IV foramen is filled. Thus, interventricular septum is formed by three parts. First is the bulbar part, second is the membranous part, and third one is the muscular part. Muscular part is developing from the floor of the ventricle. Bulbar part is developing from the bulbar ridges, which are developing in the distal part of the bulbous cordis, and gap between these two is called as IV foramen, interventricular foramen, which is filled by membranous part, and this membranous part is developing by the fused AV cushions. So this is how the interventricular septum is formed. Now coming to the anomalies, most common congenital anomaly of the heart is ventricular septal defect, and most commonly it occurs in the membranous part of the IV septum, because it fills the gap between the bulbar and the muscular part. So if this membranous part of the IV septum is not formed, then the gap remain between these two septum, bulbar and muscular septum, and lead to formation of the ventricular septal defect. And so because of ventricular septal defect, there will be communication between left ventricle and the right ventricle. As we know, after birth, pulmonary circulation has been started, so the pressure in the left ventricle is more than the right ventricle, so there will be flow of blood from the left ventricle to the right ventricle. And because of shunting of the blood from left ventricle to the right ventricle, the cardiac output from the left ventricle will be reduced, and it will lead to fatigue on exertion. So if the VSD is very small, there will be no symptom, but if the patient, if there is exertion and the VSD is large enough, there will be fatigue on exertion. Now coming to the Fallot's tetralogy, or the tetralogy of Fallot, it is the most common congenital cystic heart disease, and it is combination of four cardiac anomalies. And here the four cardiac anomalies are pulmonary stenosis, and because of pulmonary stenosis, there will be decreased flow from the right ventricle, and it will lead to right ventricular hypertrophy. And here is VSD. So because of increased pressure in the right ventricle due to right ventricular hypertrophy, there will be shunting of blood from right ventricle to the left ventricle. So it is the right to left shunting of blood, and it will lead to cyanosis. And in this condition is also associated with overriding of aorta because of development of spiral septum very anteriorly. What is spiral septum? It divides the truncus arteriosus into ascending aorta and pulmonary trunk. So if it is excessively anteriorly located, there will be overriding of the aorta. So the TOF, or the tetralogy of Fallot, is a combination of four anomalies. They are pulmonary stenosis, right ventricular hypertrophy, ventricular septal defect, and overriding of the aorta. And in this condition, there is right to left shunting of the blood, and that will lead to cyanosis. If tetralogy of Fallot is also associated with ASD, then it is called as pantology of the Fallot. Now, what is triology of the Fallot? In the triology of Fallot, first two, pulmonary stenosis is there, and that will lead to right ventricular hypertrophy. Two conditions are present, and it is also associated with ASD. So in pantology is ASD, and in triology also ASD is there. So in triology, pulmonary stenosis with RVH, right ventricular hypertrophy, with ASD. And in pantology, TOF is associated with ASD. So that's all about the development of interventricular septum and VSDs. Thank you.